thousand generations, the falling down in worship, to sing a song of ages to the Lord. And all have gone before us, and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. 'Cause your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name, it stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and possessions, your name, it stands above them all. And the angels cry, come on, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, come sing the song forever. hear your people sing.
We cry, holy, holy, holy. God, you are the one who is worthy. You are the one who is holy. And there is none beside you. So we give you our hearts. We give you our lives. We pray that you'd help us to lay them down to you. God, all the crowns that we've gained or that we've been given, that we've found in this life, they pale in comparison next to the treasure of you and your Son, Jesus. And so I pray that he would be our treasure and our prize, that he would be the meditation of our hearts and of our minds, and that you would lead us in following you, that we would fall at your feet to honor you, to glorify you, to give you the praise, even a small amount that you deserve. So lead us, Lord. And God, I pray that we would give our figurative crowns to you as well as our literal crowns to you, that you'd lead us in giving our tithes and our offerings to you, that you'd show us how to do it and what it means and what it's supposed to be. We need your help. So we pray, bless what we give today and every day for your kingdom, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Yeah, that was incredible. Those are some scenes from Graceful Christmas 2022. Who in this room was there last year? Was it a great time? Just say that it is, even if it wasn't. No, I'm just kidding. It was a great time. You got to see a little bit of what was happening. We got a ton of great performers lined up for this year. Tickets are on sale now. And here's what I want you guys to think about. Not just, oh, I could go. I could have a good time. I would enjoy some Christmas music. There might be some timely jokes. There might be some cool outfits, some nice lighting, some good sound. But here's what I want you to think about. Who can you bring with you? Because something that is very clear is that when we're here in the building together, There's something special going on. The presence of the Lord, the joy that comes, the peace that comes from being among the people of God, it really is special. And I don't just say that because I want you guys to go. I really mean it. When we're here, whether it's on a Sunday or a Wednesday, and our hope is that you would just think through and even pray through a few people. Maybe you have some neighbors that you've been connecting with, or you have a coworker or some family members that you would consider, you'd prayerfully consider inviting. Someone bought tickets today, and they're like, I'm going to buy 2 tickets. No, wait, I'm going to buy 4 tickets. I got a neighbor that I'm trying to get to know. Wait, I'm going to buy 6 tickets. I got another set of neighbors that I'm going to get to know, and it's only $30. So the idea is that we come and enjoy each other. That was you. Yes. Good job. You did it. You did exactly what I'm asking other people to do. But the hope is that we can bring people into our community. They can experience what we experience on a regular basis. The joy of the Lord. It's not going to be, you know, gospel in your face, talk about Jesus the whole time. But the hope is that we can encounter the presence of God together and allow our friends and our family to do it. So more than buying tickets, I want everyone in this room and everybody watching online to buy tickets. But I also want you to really consider, like, could I just buy 1 ticket for a friend or 2 tickets for a couple of my family members and just see what happens, see what the Spirit of God can do when they're in the house of the Lord. Can you commit to at least thinking about it? Okay, tickets are on sale now. You can buy them here today. You can buy them online. It's going to be a great time. They're $5. $5. That's not much. I don't even think you can get a coffee for $5 anymore. Yeah, there we go. The whole block. He's going to invite the whole block. That's a challenge to everybody else. How many blocks can you invite? Let us know. But for those of you who are new to Grace, you can text hello. We just want to point you in the right direction, connect you with people that are on the journey as well. You can also find a card in the back of the seats. We just want to connect you to people who are on the journey, point you in the right direction, help know how you can kind of get connected in community at Grace. So that's it for announcements. Why don't you guys stand up? Say hello to someone around you. Tell them how many blocks of people you're going to invite to Graceful Christmas.
Home am I in light of everything that you would choose to set your eyes on me? It blows my mind to think that you would know my name and I'm adored by the King of Kings. Whenever the clouds come into my mind, I won't forget it's you who tells the sun to shine. Every worry, every night, every second thought about tomorrow's wasting time. Hey, you give the sparrows everything they need. You light the stars and you paint the leaves. And you grow the lilies with your majesty. Break it down 2 times.
In the beginning.
Good morning, Grace. How are you?
Thanks, Doug. I really need that. Appreciate it. Appreciate it a lot. Let's open up with a word of prayer. My name is Wayne Stapleton. I'm the guest speaker, but also I'm an elder, right? So I kind of work here a little bit more than I used to. So there's that. Would you bow your heads with me in prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, we invite your presence this morning. We know you're already here, Lord God, but we want to be sensitive to you. We pray that you meet each of us where we are. Speak to each circumstance, each need, each struggle, each question. Jesus, do a transformative work in us, not just as individuals, but even as a body. Holy Spirit, provide clarity where there's confusion. Provide peace where there's chaos. Point the way to repentance for those of us carrying sin. And each of us grant not just the understanding of discernment, but a deepening desire for discernment. And may we draw near to you now that you might draw near to us. Raise awareness in each of us of the things in our lives that block our ability to discern your voice. And give us patience to wait for you to speak when you decide it's time. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to be preaching Genesis 8, verses 1 through 19, as we're continuing through the sermon series on Genesis. I'm not preaching the whole of chapter 8, verses 1 through 19. It's on page 6 of your pew Bibles and on page 34 of the journal that I know all of you are diligently filling out rigorously. I'm going to be reading some passages, so I invite you to stand up as I read through some of the passages from Genesis 8. If you would stand with me, I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 5 and then 14 through 19. But God remembered Noah and all the beasts and all the livestock that were with him in the ark. God made a wind blow over the earth and the waters subsided. The fountains of the deep and the windows of the heavens were closed. The rain from the heavens was restrained and the waters receded from the earth continually. And at the end of 150 days, the waters had abated. And in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. And the waters continued to abate until the 10th month. In the 10th month, on the first day of the month, the tops of the mountains were seen. And in verse 14, in the second month, on the 27th day of the month, the earth had dried out. Then God said to Noah, go out from the ark, you and your wife and your sons' wives with you. Bring out with you every living thing that is with you of all flesh, birds and animals and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, that they may swarm on the earth and be fruitful and multiply on the earth. So Noah went out and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him. Every beast, every creeping thing, and every bird, everything that moves on the earth, went out by families from the ark. You may be seated. Genesis 8, verses 1 through 19, both begin and end with the movement of God. We're continuing with the story of Noah as the flood is subsiding, and I was delivered this passage of scripture to preach on. How do you preach on the land is drying? What's our message today? No more mud. What we see is a picture of Noah, though, really. What we see is a picture of Noah actively waiting for a word from God. Noah's positioning himself in a place of discernment. And this can help each of us grow in our walk with Jesus. In this passage, God is recreating the earth. He's rebooting humanity, and Noah is his representative. In this reboot process, God is leading while Noah's actively waiting for God's instructions. In verse 1, we see that God remembered. It's the first thing we read. God remembers doesn't mean that God could have possibly forgotten Noah. It doesn't mean he could have or did forget him. It means God is about to act on their behalf. When we read that God remembers somebody in Scripture, it's initiating the idea that God is about to act on behalf of that person that he remembers. And he doesn't only remember Noah, he remembers all the beasts and the livestock that are with him in the ark as well. And in this remembering, we're reading that God is initiating the drying out of the earth after the flood. The flood was sudden and dramatic, but the drying of the earth is a slow and gradual process. And just like Noah and his family had to depend on God in the ark during the flood, they continue to need to depend on him and wait for his provision as the land is drying out so they can repopulate the land. It's important to remember that the deliverance from the flood was not really complete until every occupant in the ark was back on dry land. The point was never to go for a ride on a boat. The point was God's rebooting of humanity. Now, this water description I find is amazing. The water was coming from two directions, not just one. It was coming from below the deep and above, and God stopped both. We read in Genesis 7:11, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the 17th day of the month, On that day, all the fountains of the great deep burst forth, and the windows of the heavens were opened. Now, in 8:2, it's the exact opposite. We read that the fountains of the deep and the windows of the heavens were closed, and the rain from the heavens was restrained. It reminds me of that flood we had in Grosse Pointe a few years ago. You remember that flood? Tanya was out of town, and Stephen and Adam and I were at home. And we went downstairs at like 1 or 2 in the morning, and the water was coming up out of the drain from the fountains of the deep that God apparently decided that was a good time to open those up too. And we were scrambling to get boxes off the floor. Remember that, Stephen? Yeah. So back to Noah. The waters receded continually, and at some point the ark rested, no longer afloat, but now on land. Now Ararat is not a mountain. It's a range of mountains in what is now Turkey. Because the ark, a boat, landed on a mountain, one would assume that the waters still needed to go down because, you know, boats and mountains don't normally go together. That's not over because the waters no longer cleared the tops of the mountains. More needed to be done. More drying out needed to happen. And more drying took place until the 10th month when one could see the tops of other apparently smaller mountains. Now, what I found interesting in this passage was we read five actions on Noah's part to determine what it's like outside. Noah waited for the land to dry, but more so, he was waiting for God to give him the signal. But Noah was waiting in an active way. We read in verse 6, at the end of 40 days, the first action that Noah took was to open the windows of the ark that he had made, and he sent out a raven. Now, I'm not sure why he sent out a raven, except for a raven is an unclean bird, and if you remember, there are one pair of unclean animals and seven pairs of clean animals. So there's only one pair of ravens in the ark, and maybe Noah felt less attached to the raven, so he was more comfortable sending a raven than a dove. But then we read that Noah sent a dove. Now, unlike a raven, doves are clean animals. They would be used in ritual sacrifice once they are back on dry land and doing those ceremonial rituals. So there were seven pairs of doves on the ark. And I love how the Bible describes Noah and the dove here. It's almost like they have a relationship. You can sense Noah's care for the bird. The dove had no place to set her foot, so Noah put out his hand and took her and brought her into the ark with him. It almost makes you think he gave her a name. I don't know what you'd name a dove, but after seven more days, we read, Noah sent the dove again. It doesn't say he sent a dove. It says he sent the dove, which means it seems like he keeps sending the same dove. I don't know if this dove is happy about this, but this time the dove comes back with an olive leaf. And like, again, I don't know how he distinguished this dove from the other doves because doves all look alike to me, but maybe not Noah. The leaf was Noah's sign that the waters had subsided, that plants were growing. And this experiment that Noah was conducting was yielding proof that the earth was drying, that they're moving in the right direction toward repopulation of the earth again. But if you notice, God had not given Noah the signal to leave. So Noah stayed on the ark and did some more testing. He waited seven more days, and Noah sent out the dove again, and this time it didn't return. And that was a good sign. She might have been mad that Noah kept picking her to go out. She said, I'm out, Noah, peace. In verse 13, we read that Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked, and behold, the face of the ground was dry. And we see throughout this dry out period that Noah was running his own tests, doing his own research. And this time he removed the covering of the ark, and he could literally see that the ground was dry. We read that. But I want to put a pin in this idea that he saw the earth was dry in year 601 on the first month, the first day of the month. He sees with his own eyes that the earth is dry, and he doesn't leave. We read that almost 2 months later, after seeing that the earth was dry, Noah was still in the smelly ark with all these animals because God had not yet said, it's time to leave. At the appointed time, we read, God spoke to Noah. He told him it's time to leave the ark, and God encouraged him, bring out all the animals and all the living things with you, even the biting flies, because God was going to have biting flies bite people and the reboot of humanity. And he told them to be fruitful and multiply, which we read in Genesis 1:22 to the animals and Genesis 1:28 to the people. So that's what they did. They left the ark then. They let God lead them, waiting for him to tell them when to go. Again, Noah saw with his own two eyes from all his testing and research, the earth was dry, but he waited until God said, it's time for you to leave the ark. How many of us operate on what we see rather than when it's time God is telling us, this is what I need you to do? Similar to Noah, you and I need to be in a posture of waiting, an active waiting, being able to hear God and responding faithfully when we do. This is discernment, the ability to judge well. And there's a couple of components to this discernment. One of them is just a posture of humble submission to the will of God, saying, I'm not going to go anywhere until you say go. But then when you get the order, then it's time to go. For followers of Jesus, judging well is judgment that was given to you, is given to you by God. I would argue, probably in my years of preaching, that the most quoted verse I think I've used in my preaching is Luke 9:23. If anyone would come after me, Jesus said, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Following Jesus is letting him lead, distinguishing between what is right and wrong and what we need to do next. And not just what we need to do next, but sometimes even when we need to do it. Noah's posture was one of humble waiting for God to lead him out of the ark. And this is discernment. Discernment is crucial to being led by God. We must move as God guides and not before. When we prioritize what we can see in the present, we can miss getting direction from the God who knows our future. We might pull the trigger on taking or quitting the job, on starting or ending the relationship, on starting or quitting a serving role in church, any number of things, before there's clarity that God is actually in our decision. And what's required from us is a posture of humble submission, like Noah, of patience, of unwillingness to respond apart from the will of God. He was in the ark for a year. Again, how do you think it smelled? They might not have had any, like, smelling whatever system in there after being on the ark that long. Noah saw that the ground was dry. But God stayed put and said, until God said, it's time to go. Our ability or our willingness to respond faithfully is an issue of how we are being formed as disciples, as followers of Jesus. We may not always get it right. We pretty much probably won't, but we can grow in our discernment when we're intentional and sensitive to what God is doing in and around us. Discernment is important for us today because, like during the time of Noah, God is still doing a work of renewal. He's still moving in people's lives. He's growing his church. He's ministering reconciliation and healing and transformation in communities and families. And we are, like Noah, God's representatives. And we as his people are only going to be able to join God in this work of renewal to the extent that we develop and grow in our ability to discern when God is moving and how he invites us to join him. This is how God leads us. This is how we honor Jesus when Jesus said, if anyone will come after me, let this person deny themselves and take up their cross every day and follow me. It's 2023. I know that's not a surprise for you. It's November. But it's been exactly 20 years since I quit my consulting job and my family moved to Illinois so I could attend seminary. I've done the best I can to discern the voice of God, and I've sought to make the moves that I felt like he was leading me to. As most of you know, or many of you know, I served on staff here from 2008 to 2012. But toward the end of that time, I felt God give me a clear call to lead a church, and that's what I did. And during my time pastoring Renewal, I also began to work with our North American Baptist Conference leadership. And after some time, I recognized that the assignment God had given me at Renewal was even beginning to change again. I felt different about the city of Warren than I had felt before. I remember having this strong affinity to the city of Warren and the streets there and the neighbors there. But toward the end, I remember feeling like I'd lost that affinity. I talked with Tanya about it. I processed it with mentors and coaches. And then the interim director of the NAB offered me a job. And it felt like that was God's answer to this question. What do you have next for me? After talking with Tanya, I decided to say yes to the job offer. And I had some conversations with the elders. I had some conversations with our leadership team. I had some conversations with the church that day. I announced it to the church that day, and that was a pretty tough day. And I got some pushback from some people. They're like, I didn't hear that. I don't know how you heard that, right? If God said it to you, why ain't he say it to me? I responded by committing to fast and to pray for 3 days just to confirm what I thought I was hearing from God. And I felt like I did hear that God said it's time. God said the assignment's changing, but he said give renewal a little more time before you make the move. So 2 weeks after I announced my intentions to the church that I was going to leave, I stood before them and said, yeah, I'm leaving, but just not yet. It was a little up and down. And I say all that to say I haven't been perfect in my attempts to allow the leadership of the Holy Spirit to guide me. But I've sought to be earnest to do what God was telling me. And I also want to respect the voices of others in the process. And what you and I need to know is discernment isn't just for pastoral ministry or ministry leaders or spiritual superstars. Followers of Jesus need discernment with every decision we make, because literally that's what following Jesus means. I'm not saying this to imply that we need to be scared or petrified of doing anything. It's just that we probably need the leadership and guidance of God, the discernment that we can get from the Holy Spirit, a lot more than we usually give him credit for. We need discernment in our relationships, in school activities, in our jobs, in our habits, in our media choices, in how we see the world around us, and in everything we are and do. I've read estimates that we make about 35,000 relatively conscious decisions each day. Depending on how long you live, that could be a billion in your lifetime. For instance, what to wear, what and when to eat, when to sleep and how long, what will be on my to-do list, who you choose to be friends with, whose influence you choose to ignore, how you spend your weekend, when to speak up, when to be silent, how much money to save, where to save it, how to spend it, where to donate it, whether to have children and how many, what to name them, and Wayne is always available for boys, where they go to school, who they play with, how to raise them, should I take the umbrella out, and more and more and more. Not to mention what some of you are wrestling with is where I'm going to eat when this man's done talking. If you're a parent or a guardian of a young person, you need discernment. If you're a teen, you need discernment. You need to know the will of God. If you're a church leader, you need discernment. If you attend church, you need discernment. If you're a grandparent, you need discernment. If you're employed, you need discernment. If you're not employed, willingly or otherwise, you need discernment. If you're breathing, you need discernment. If you can hear me, you need discernment. If you can't hear me, I don't know. But God hears all of it. God cares about all of it. God cares about all of what's going on in our lives. Powers of discernment, sensitivity to God's voice, are not necessarily just spiritual gifts that pop up and empower us to know what God is up to and how to follow him. I talked about Noah having this posture of active waiting, where he's doing these tests to determine what's going on outside so he can get an idea of when God might say go out. We need to be living in a state of active waiting if we don't have direct answers from God yet as well. Powers of discernment are to be trained and cultivated. We're to commit our lives to them. Hebrews 5:14 reminds us that solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. We don't cruise into a deeper level of discernment. We don't fall into a deeper level of discernment. It's constant practice. It's commitment. Discernment of what God wants for us comes from intention and practice. It's not just enough to say you believe. That's a great starting point. But discernment is not just knowing what God's will, it's actively doing it as well. Applying the Word of God to our lives, to our circumstances, to our activities. And I believe that we discern poorly today for a lot of reasons. We discern poorly today in part because our commitments aren't fully always about God's work in us and in the world. Our commitments are often about our interests, our insecurities, our fears, our pride, our self-centeredness, and more. We discern poorly because our core commitments can be political and not spiritual. We can run every aspect of the world through a political grid first, making political commitments more foundational than the word of God. We discern poorly today because we don't have time for reflection and prayer. We're too busy with our activities, our habits, our sleep, or other pursuits to take real time on our knees in quiet reflection to invite the guidance of God into our lives. We discern poorly today because we don't spend enough meaningful, transformative time with brothers and sisters in Christ who can impact us positively for the kingdom. We discern poorly today because we're not always looking for the right places, in the right places, for what God is doing in the world. We're enamored with platforms and stages, and we draw blood when big names fall. But we often overlook the least, the last, and the lost. When God moves among those with no platform and reveals his tender care for them, God is not as impressed with fame or numbers or the size of events as we are. We're told that all of heaven rejoices when one sinner comes to faith in Jesus. But we might tell God rookie numbers. If we're to be led by God, we must grow in our discernment of his will. What kinds of things do we need to grow in our discernment? How do you feel about your ability, even now in the moment, to really have a sense of what God is saying and doing, how he's leading you, what's your next steps, or how you're applying yourself to learning what God might want for you? I want to highlight, as I close here, three catalysts that can help us grow in our discernment. I'm sure they will be no surprise to you. I'm going to talk about our perspective, I'm going to talk about the role of prayer, and I'm going to talk about being a member of the church. Sometimes I feel like every sermon I give is a prelude to tell people, pray more and read your Bible. Thank you. Have a good evening. The first catalyst, though, for discernment is our perspective. We need to check our perspective. Discernment about what God is doing in the world has got to begin with the way we understand God and what he's up to. What is the lens or grid through which you view yourself and the world around you? We get this from Scripture, which is clear that God is a God of love. I was at a conference earlier this year, and a pastor, Jeff Vanderstelt, was teaching, and he said something I never heard before. He said, love is the goal of discipleship. I've heard love emphasized as important. I've heard God described as love. But I've never heard, until he said that, love as the goal of discipleship. The implicit message I always got was the point of discipleship is always be right about every jot and tittle of your doctrine. And being right is equivalent to being faithful, which I don't think is necessarily true. I'm not saying being right is wrong, but I am saying Jesus himself said that the first commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength. And a second one is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Love is pretty primary to God. But the question is, as a follower of Jesus, is love primary to you? If so, can your enemies tell? Is that how they describe you? Can people unlike you in your theological commitments tell? Can your political foes tell? If you tell me we can't merely love, we also must be truthful, then I say you're missing this idea that God believes his love is strong and powerful enough. Love and truth are not at odds. And if you say, well, you know, maybe in order to get God's will done today, we need to choose a method different than love, I'd say you don't understand God. Our perspective must be grounded on God as a God of love, and our role is to follow
him in loving in his power. And this comes from immersing ourselves in his word so we can see his love in action in his word and then in us and around us. A perspective shift that's not founded on the word of God will lead us astray. But I heard a past pastor, Brian Zahn, once wrote that if you read scripture and you're not motivated to love God and others more, then you've read it wrong. The church cannot hate its enemies into the kingdom, nor show hatred of them, thinking we're showing them Jesus. Yes. We're most definitely called to oppose sin. We have to. And we're definitely called to be Christ's witnesses in a broken world. Yet I wonder if we really do love people we claim to. I wonder if we really do love the different. I wonder if we really do love everyone made in God's image, even when we can't identify with them. Or refuse to put in the effort to. The perspective of the love of God will guide the places and ways he will lead us. It will drive our discernment. How might your love of neighbor grow? Are you in touch with areas in your heart that aren't God-honoring toward your neighbor? So we're not told how God spoke to Noah. We do know from scripture how God wants us to connect with him. And in addition to a perspective shift, we can't discern what God is doing apart from a consistent and intentional and growing life of prayer. I don't understand a commitment to Christ that's not accompanied by a commitment to prayer. Jesus died and was raised for us to be in relationship with the triune God. If our salvation is about being brought into fellowship with Father, Son, and Spirit, and if we are in Christ as the Spirit is in us and gives us fellowship with the Father, that's a relationship that calls for cultivation. I don't know how we work on cultivating our connection and relationship with the triune God apart from spending time with him in contemplative listening and speaking prayer. How committed to prayer are you? How significant is prayer in your life? Do you find prayer to be a constant for you, or do you only go to prayer when you feel out of control? So we need a perspective check. We need to be people of prayer, and we also need to recognize the value that God has for us of everybody around us, the people of God, our partners. Now, I would say this is a little different than Noah. Noah was in a different situation. God communicated directly to Noah. We have the Spirit of God. He's given us Christian community. In the West, we typically see the church as a bunch of individuals, but God saved a church, and he describes it as one body. In Scripture, when we see the church make moves and we see important things happen, we often see them gather together in one accord in prayer. When you become a Christian, it's not that you have to go to church. You become privileged to be part of the people of God, partners in living out the kingdom ethics of Jesus Christ. Which means that this is a wonderful building in which we meet, but we would equally be the people of God if we all were gathered in a parking lot downtown. We hear from God in community. We grow spiritually in community. We serve others in community. We help them grow in community. We show them by our actions that our greatest concern is their eternal benefit. We love one another in Christian community. Community is one of the ways God leads us. Community is one of the ways we gauge our discernment. But that means we have to be open to one another and invite one another into our lives. I need to be aware of what God is doing inside of us. Do we have people like that in our lives? Are you trying to discern God's will on your own because you're not sharing what you feel like God is saying to you? Too few people, I think, marvel at what God has done bringing us into his family as his children. In 1 John 3:1, it's written, "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are." Do you realize that because of Jesus Christ, the day is going to come, if you trust in him, you're going to stand before the perfect maker of heaven and earth, blameless. And only you know everything you've done, which Only you know how crazy that really sounds. But it's true. Who are your partners in discernment? Who do you trust to listen with you? Noah was led by God, and so are we to be led by God as well. God has given us his word. He's given us the ability to pray. He's given us one another. We have access to all we need to judge God's will in us and for us. We also have access to the Holy Spirit, who gives us the patience to not move till God says move. To trust in Jesus that when it's time to move, he'll let us know and give us everything we need to make those moves. Our need to be led by God is no less important than Noah's, because God is still doing a work of renewal in the world. Let's not miss opportunities God's giving us by focusing on something lesser than his love and what he wants to do in and through us as his people. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we worship you and we praise your holy, perfect, and righteous name. We pray that you would just grant us your purposes and your will. We pray that you give us the ability, the strength to be patient if we want to move and we want to jump and we want to go somewhere, but you're telling us not yet. But we also pray for courage so that when the time comes for us to do the different thing, or in all the various decisions that we have to make on a daily basis, Lord God, that you just give us the wisdom and the courage to do those things as you lead us. Father, we thank you and praise you that every aspect of our lives matters to you. And every aspect of our lives can bring you glory if we allow it to. Challenge us, Lord God, so that we would grow in this area. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. I don't know how many sermons I've preached, but I know that every time I get up here, I'm like nervous. I'm like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? I think that's a good sign, maybe. There are people that prayed beforehand. And this is what they heard. If this resonates with you, and even if it doesn't, please feel free to come down. There will be prayer counselors here after the service. They said someone needs to know that Jesus is with them all the time. Someone seeking transformation. I actually think probably these two means all of you should come. No. Then there's troubled marriages. Please come down here for prayer if you feel like your marriage is in trouble. Correction of wrong thinking. Lord gives insight, discernment maybe, I don't know. If you have jaw pain, please come down for prayer. Heal someone hiding from emotional pain. Comfort from loss, they heard a lot of things. And then consumed with current events needs to be consumed with Jesus.
That's hot.
Yeah. So anyway, if any of these applies to you, please come down to the front and receive prayer. But thanks for being here and have a great day.